Does your school have cliques? You know, those groups of people who they just bond together based on things they have in common? I mean, at my school there was the band clique, you know, or the sports clique, or like three-pointer, or the smart kids, me, duh. Or even the church kids, me, again. I mean, I think I was like all those kids at one point or another. See, while you might get along well and have a ton in common with the people in your clique, you might have a lot of strong opinions about the people in other cliques, the ones who are maybe a little different from you. So in middle school, I had my group of friends, there were another, whatever, there were a bunch of groups of friends. Basically, whoever you sat with at the lunch table, right? You know what I'm talking about. So there's this one kid, we'll call him Joe. Now Joe, he was not a part of my clique. We didn't really hang out that much. When Joe and I did hang out, it wasn't really the best of times. See, Joe wasn't really nice, like at all. So anytime I would run into Joe, do you think he was handing out candy bars? No. Joe was actually kind of a bully. And not only to me, but a couple kids in our grade. And every time I ran into him, I thought, this kid is just a big meanie. Man, he's just the worst. How could anybody ever want to hang out with him? This kid was just never fun to be around. He was never nice to anyone. I mean, this guy was just kind of mean. He was rude, impolite, young gentleman. Here's the truth. We all have those kinds of opinions about other people, right? I mean, oftentimes it's easy for us to form opinions or assume we know things to be true about people who are different than us. I mean, sure, we don't know them all that well, but we definitely think we do. And what we think to be true of them becomes our opinion of who they actually are. Think for just a minute about the cliques in and around your school. You probably have assumptions or opinions about each and every one of them. Maybe you've thought things like, the rich kids are, all the people on the sports teams are, the smart kids are, those cheerleaders are, the band kids are. And I bet right now you're filling in each of these blanks with what you think you know about each one of these groups of people. I mean, we all do it. Even here at church, I bet you found yourself looking around and noticing cliques or groups of people and have thoughts like, the kids who always come to church, they're, or those students from school, they're always, or those kids in the younger grades, they are always, again, we form opinions about these people based on our assumptions. And just like that, our opinions become facts. And what's really tricky is that those opinions or assumptions come from all kinds of places. Maybe you think something about a certain group of people because of a past experience you have. Maybe they bullied you, or hurt you, or embarrassed you, or just weren't all that kind. Maybe you saw them act a certain way or do a certain thing, but whatever it was, that experience shaped your opinion. Or maybe for you, it really is just an assumption. You don't actually know the things you believe or think about that person or group of people are true. You just think it might be true. And for you, that assumption is enough to change your opinion. Or maybe for you, it's an opinion based in jealousy or insecurity. Yep, you, me, jealous, insecure, ha, never, a lot of the time actually. Those other people have something you want or wish you had. And because you don't, you have negative feelings or opinions about them. Whatever the reason, when it comes to people who are different than us, people we don't really understand, we let our judgments and opinions affect how we view them. That's a problem for a lot of reasons. I mean, for starters, our judgments aren't usually nice and kind thoughts. We aren't typically describing people we don't really know with words like awesome or so cool or they're just so fun to be around. Not only does that mean we're judging or seeing them negatively, but it also means we probably aren't going to give them a chance in the future. I mean, we've already made up our minds, right? We don't need to get to know them or learn anything else about them because in our minds, we already know who they are. here's what I think we're missing. When we base our view of someone else on one experience or one opinion or one assumption, we aren't seeing the whole story. We aren't seeing the whole person. Okay, so there's a story in the Bible that I think can help us change the way we see other people. It's found in the book of John, which was written by one of Jesus's closest friends and followers named John. Duh. John was one of 12 men who walked closest with Jesus and learned from him during his ministry on earth. John wrote down what he actually saw, heard, and experienced as a follower of Jesus. And that's what we have to look at today. When we pick up our story, Jesus was teaching to a group of people when several religious leaders interrupted him with a question. "Teacher," they said to Jesus, "this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say?" So basically, these religious leaders came to Jesus with a question about a woman who was caught sleeping with someone who wasn't her husband. That's so awkward. And the religious leaders, they knew the rules. They understood what the law said. Back then, when somebody committed adultery, they'd be stoned. And that basically means people would literally throw stones at them until they died. What? These religious leaders thought they knew exactly what Jesus was gonna say about this woman. They were so sure that they interrupted his teaching just to get the answer. And they knew the answer was not only going to prove they were right about who this woman was, but also show how much better they were than she was. Now, can we all admit that we, just like the religious leaders, have a tendency to think better of ourselves than we do about others? We tend to see what other people do or who they are much differently than the way we see ourselves. And because of that, we've put space between us and them. We let our opinions and judgments define who they are, and we slowly move ourselves away from them. That's exactly what these religious leaders were doing with this woman. That's probably what they thought Jesus would do too. Instead, Jesus did something I don't think anybody expected. The religious leaders kept demanding an answer. So he stood up again and said, "All right, but let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone." Then he stooped down again and wrote in the dust. My man had no time for these guys, not enough time. He sat and wrote in the dust. See, Jesus challenged these religious leaders to look inward at themselves and their own sin instead of just judging others. Jesus told them that the one who hadn't sinned, who had never messed up or ever made a mistake or ever done anything wrong, was the only one who had the right to throw a stone at this woman. And as you can imagine, no one there besides Jesus fell into that category. While they were standing there, the religious leaders felt convicted and their argument shut down completely. Instead of throwing stones like they planned, John wrote, "After they heard what Jesus said, they slipped away one by one by one. And soon it was only Jesus left standing with this woman." Here's what happened next. "Then Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, 'Where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you?' 'No, Lord,' she said. And Jesus said, 'Neither do I. Go and sin no more.'" While the religious leaders had judged this woman on only one thing they knew about her, Jesus saw something else. Jesus saw this woman as so much more than one bad decision. She was so much more than one opinion or one judgment or one experience. Jesus knew the whole story and he loved her no matter what. Nobody in this story was really who everyone else thought they'd be. Everyone judged this woman as bad, but Jesus showed that she was worthy of forgiveness and a future. Everyone judged these religious leaders as good, but Jesus showed that they were no better than the woman they came to stone. The truth is, we are all made in the image of God, and that alone makes us worthy of his love and forgiveness. That's That's the way Jesus saw other people, and he calls us to see them in the same way. Jesus wants us to remember that there's more to other people than just our opinions of them. Kind of like my friend Joe we talked about earlier, who was kind of mean to me. You see, later in the school year, another kid was picking on me, and out of nowhere, Joe came up and stood in between the two of us and defended me. He told the other kid to walk away and leave me alone. But I thought Joe was just mean, but maybe he's not always like that. Maybe my one experience with him isn't who he actually is. You see, reducing someone to just one judgment or opinion causes you to miss so much. I mean, those band kids at your school, maybe they're really funny, but you have no idea because you've judged them as boring. Those cheerleaders in the lunchroom might be the nicest people in your grade, but you just assume they're mean, and that's become who they are in your eyes. Those kids in your small group who come to church all the time, maybe they're struggling with the same things you are, but you'll never know because they're perfect in your opinion. You might be missing out on so much about someone by simply letting your opinions and judgments define them. So my challenge to you is to remember this. There's more to others than just our opinions of them. To help you remember, I want you to try one of these two things this week. First, worry about yourself. Yeah, I'm calling you out. When you find yourself about to form an opinion or make a judgment about someone else, worry about yourself instead. Just as Jesus reminded those religious leaders, we've all got our own mistakes and missteps to worry about. So instead of focusing on someone else's behavior or interests or choices that you don't understand, focus on what you're doing and how you can better live out the life God has for you. Or maybe remove the judgment. Think about who in your world that you've judged or formed an opinion about without truly getting to know them. What if instead of judging them with what you think you know about them, you let the facts define them? What if you only focus on what you know to be true about them? Now, while you may not know much about the other person or group of people right away, you do know this for sure. They are children of God, made in his image and deserving of his love. Just start there. Then, instead of making assumptions, think of them with compassion, love, and kindness and grace, just like Jesus did. Remember, there's more to others than just our opinions of them. As you head out today, ask yourself this question. What's one way I form opinions about people who are different than me?